Moses spoke to the people, "Remember the long way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, in order to humble you, testing you to know what is in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commandments. He humbled you by letting you hunger, then by feeding you with manna, with which neither you nor your ancestors were acquainted, in order to make you understand that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. who led you through the great and terrible wilderness, an arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow for you from the flint rock and led you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and to test you, and in the end, to do you good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm. Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion. For he strengthens the bars of your gates. He blesses your children within you.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He grants peace within your borders. He fills you with the finest of wheat. He sends out his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and ordinances to Israel. He has not dealt thus with any other nation. They do not know his ordinances.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. The word of the Lord.
So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. The Gospel of the Lord. So, my dear friends, today we celebrate the solemnity of the body and blood of Christ. We are reminded of God's abiding presence in the Eucharist. The first reading underlines that abiding presence. During their experience in the Exodus, in the wilderness, the Israelites, remember, they were leaving captivity in Egypt to the Promised Land. Well, as they were embarking on that journey, they were facing the unknown, the dangers of the wilderness, a harsh environment, little access to food and water. But all of this was for a reason. And the reason was so that they could put their trust totally in God, that they could see God as provider. And so they could put aside any fear and negativity. God's creative and loving energy would sustain them through that arduous journey. And so manna is sent from heaven. Water springs forth from the rock. Trust and faith open a channel through which God can work, and again, overcoming fear and negativity. The gospel passage from John also makes reference to manna, God's gift of daily bread that nourished the Hebrew people in the desert. Except in this case, Jesus makes it very clear. As the Word made flesh, Jesus is himself God's very own gift. And if we eat of his body and drink of his blood, then we shall have life within us, fullness of life and everlasting life. He is the nourishment that satisfies. He is the food that has the power to transform every person and indeed the world. For us believers, the power of the Eucharist, yes, is present here at the altar, here at the table of the Word. And of course, it has a very special place in our lives when we are gathered, so that we can be nourished and satisfied. And thanks be to God, in a few short days, this Tuesday, we will have that experience of being part of the gathering around the Eucharistic table. And next weekend, our first Sunday gathering, after 3 months or more of being isolated. But the power of the Eucharist also transforms us. It is life-giving, and it can reach hearts and minds in ways that are unimagined. What do I mean? Well, about 2 weeks ago, we saw how the pandemic hit a farm not far from here in the Norfolk region. Approximately 170 migrant farm workers were exposed and infected, and a number of them even very sick. were staggering. And in that moment of emergency, an immediate decision had to be made, because 170 men that had to be quarantined in one small region would not suffice. And so it was decided, wisely, that about 120 of them would be housed here in the Brantford area in hotels. Again, under strict quarantine, meaning the men could not leave the rooms, let alone the premises. And that way they could be cared for and looked after medically and all of their needs. Now, a few people raised concerns about how this decision came about. It was a surprise. And there was concerns how it would impact our area, because our numbers have been pretty good, relatively low. Sadly, though, a few, saw the presence as a threat, and even questioned why bother caring for them here. They should go back to Mexico, that's where they're from. Now that attitude, that sentiment, bothered me. It grieved me. It angered me greatly. These men are not here as tourists. They're not just passerbys. They come here, spending months, 8 months or more, working hard day in and day out, toiling in the fields, producing food that comes to our tables, and for a wage that no Canadian would ever work for. They're here as part of our community. And as some of you may know, I raised my concerns in different ways and through the media. But then as I gathered around me some supporters, we decided, well, what do we want to do with that anger, that righteous indignation? We didn't want to wallow or stew in that anger. And so we decided to channel that negative feeling into something positive and good. And so we put out the call, let's provide each man with a gift bag and with positive messages, especially with Father's Day so close. And dear friends, the response was overwhelming. Parishioners, neighboring churches, organizations, individuals as far away as Hamilton, Toronto, and even Vancouver responded. Yes, our efforts were recognized. But more importantly, it showed that when something was perceived as a threat, actually became a moment of grace and conversion. And not only were we able to provide enough gift bags for the 120, and the other 50 are quarantined elsewhere, but enough for all their companions, even the ones who are not sick. And still, there is more to give and share. You see, that's the power of the Eucharist at work. Yes, the Eucharist feeds us, it nourishes us, and it blesses us. And through that, we become food for others through our acts of mercy and compassion. And so let us pray that our hunger, our longing to be fed from this table, may be equally matched by our desire to feed, to nourish, and to transform the world. My dear friends, we are gathered to be nourished and fed, and also to voice our concerns, and so let us humbly present our prayers and our needs to the Lord.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving to God for the reopening of our churches this week and the opportunity to worship as members of Christ's body, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the health of those who are sick and for our planet, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our migrant farm workers, especially those who are sick, may they be restored to health, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the followers of Jesus, that we may become like him through the frequent reception of communion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are suffering the affliction of loneliness and despair, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the parishioners, living and deceased, and for Jim Boudet, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions in our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving Father, you give us lasting food for body and soul. Answer our prayers as we celebrate the Eucharistic feast. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth, the work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer, fruit of the vine, work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
Pray, sisters and brothers, that these are gifts, and our sacrifice may be acceptable and pleasing to God, the Almighty Father. Grant the Church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery, in the offerings we here present, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, my eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for the ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise. Nourishing your faithful by the sacred mystery, you make them holy, so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that made in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing the new song in adoration, and we, with the host of angels, cry out, and without end, we acclaim, Holy. You are indeed holy, O Lord God, He took bread and giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, the supper was ended, he took the chalice, once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it. Though this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim and profess until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer the Lord the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring it to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Douglas, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who fall asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Now let thy mercy welcome that into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray that, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, Blessed Apostles, St. Anthony, Daniel, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to declare us to the life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command form, by his divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, the Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days. By the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let
us now offer each other a sign of Christ's peace. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have
Diocese of Hamilton. We will be reopening with our first gathered Mass on Tuesday at 7 p.m. I want to thank in a special way all those people in the background, the handful of you who have come out every week to help in this live stream Mass. And then, of course, we will have our Sunday gathering. Now, the bishop has also said, as all the bishops from around the world, if you are sick, if you are high risk, if you've traveled, etc., all those questions we have to answer, if you have a temperature, stay home. The Sunday obligation is not as rigid in a sense, so stay home. Now, the other question you may have is, okay, Father, what about the live stream Mass? Well, up until Friday, the sense that I was getting from our bishop was that we were to discontinue live streaming the Mass, not using this platform for other ways of evangelizing, but for the Mass. I suppose His Excellency had a change of heart Friday afternoon, and we were given the green light. However, there are seven or eight conditions that have to be met. And for myself, I did not invest or plan for that. So one thing is obstructing the liturgy and having the altar area as it should be. We've had to do a little bit of rearranging, and the way we're positioned, it is obstructing. So I put it out to any of my creative parishioners. If you have a way to get around it, please let me know. And we need better technology than my iPhone, right, to make it a better quality. So that in mind, so I will continue to remain in touch, use this platform, but until I have a better way of doing the liturgy and taping it, we will not have the live stream Mass here. There will be other churches that will do that. And finally, as you know, I mentioned about the situation of the migrant workers. As I said, most of them are doing much better, and in a few short days, they should be returning back to the farms, where we will be able to share the gifts that were brought. In these 3 months, I've never made an appeal to you for money, right? Like some of my maybe friends to the south, but up there and right away, they're hitting you with money. And I didn't do that because this was our service. Plus, the generosity of parishioners allowed us to continue and to do what we could do during this strict time of the pandemic. However, I will infuse the amount of guilt in you to say, if you benefited from this, you owe me, not me, you owe the migrant workers. So if you've enjoyed it, if you followed me, God bless you. Now share that blessing, please. There's a way to do it through Facebook, or you can contact me. Whatever amount will be greatly received. $10, $50, $100, anything up to a million. Over a million, it's a little bit hard for me to count all the ones. So no, just kidding. Whatever you can give will be warmly received, so that it will go towards this initiative, because it's not just going to happen now. There's going to be needs in the coming weeks and months. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
God's blessing and peace come upon you. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration has ended. Remain in Christ's love. And I look forward to seeing the parishioners this coming week. God bless you.